evening. I'll call the open session agenda for November 27th to order. And seeing four members present, we are missing Councilmember Zimmerman, who is...
Actually, no, I'm here.
I'm sorry.
It's me, really. It is me. Trust me.
It was that invisible thing you do. Oh, God. Right. So, okay, let's start over. Wait a minute. Let's do it again. Good evening. I'll call the meeting of November 27th to order. And seeing four members of the council present, and Councilmember Watts is an excused absence, and he is attending a meeting in Las Vegas. So, and he participated in the closed session, but he will not be participating in the open session. So with that, I will ask the now visible Councilmember Zimmerman to please lead us in the pledge.
Please stand, face the flag. Place your hand over your heart.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before I came to the council chambers tonight, Councilmember Buchanan and I were talking about the horrible fire in Malibu, and we were reflecting on the fact that notwithstanding the tremendous loss of property, and I don't mean to make light of that at all, fortunately no one was killed in that inferno, and so that's actually something that I'm very thankful for and we'll contemplate. So we'll have a moment of silence. Thank you.
Great, and I will ask for a motion to proceed with the business of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Excuse me. Oh, yes, let's go ahead and have the vote, and then can we do the announcement? Okay, so it's been moved and seconded, and all in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion carries, and I will ask our city attorney to report from closed session.
No reportable action was taken in closed session, and for the comfort of the public, no direction was given to sell or lease the city parking lot.
Okay, thank you very much. So I will bring it back to the council, and we'll go ahead and start with any reports on activities from council members. And Council Member Zimmerman?
I don't have anything to report.
Okay. Mayor Pro Tem Mosca.
My office time is this Sunday, Kirsten Court at 2 p.m. as usual. If you have any questions or thoughts that you want to share with me, come on down. I'd love to meet with you. Also, I just wanted to announce a couple of things that I've attended in the past couple of weeks. Went to the prayer breakfast at the Women's Club, which was last week, and it was really nice. I want to thank the Women's Club for inviting me to that and also for organizing it. It was really a nice prayer breakfast that really gave me pause to think about all the many things that I'm thankful for, so it was really nice. Dickens Village, I also participated in with the mayor. We were able to light the Christmas tree, which was a fun event to see all the community out, all the kids playing, and all the families taking part in it. It was a very special event, so I was happy to be able to do that. I also want to announce that the Senior Commission is having their committee for the renovation of the Park House committee meet this tomorrow from 3:30 to 5:30 at the Park House. They're going to discuss the renovation of the Park House and some of the funds that were raised to do that. So if you're interested in talking about that, go down to that meeting 3:30 to 5 at the Park House. And that's about it. Thank you.
Yes, I want to congratulate the Chamber of Commerce and thank them again for the Dickens Village celebration. Sorry I got there a little later than usual, but there was an executive at Edison who didn't seem to think the urgency I placed on Dickens Village was the same as his. But I also want to mention that the Malibu fire, as horrible as it was, we should be thankful again that our firefighters were there. We did have firefighters out there. I believe Battalion Chief Bamberger was leading a crew out there, if I'm not mistaken. At least I know he was out there. I didn't get the names of the others, but once again, our firefighters were plying their trade at a critical time for the benefit of all of us. The Women's Club, again, the prayer breakfast also, I was there, and it was it's just one of those cozy sort of down-home kind of things that make you feel very good about yourself when you sit through it and enjoy the wisdom and the thoughts that go on there. And with that, I think I did want to say, and I know we'll do this in a more formal way at some point, but as many of you know, Chief Lowe will step down from the fire chief's position in January, but he'll still be around. However, if you see him, oh, there he is. He's not nearly as visible as Kurt, but there he is. He's visible over there. And Roger, thank you for all your service in anticipation, and I'm sure we will, in anticipation of an event where I'm sure we will give you more formal thanks later on.
That's very good. Thank you. And I have a couple of things to report. We managed to light the Christmas tree thanks to the tag team effort of Mayor Pro Tem Joe Mosca and myself. And prayer breakfast was most enjoyable and very touching. It was nice to hear from all the ministers, and we even had a rabbi this year. So that was really nice. Couple things to point out. One is that you'll notice there's a new format to the agenda. We got some good feedback at the last meeting about how we might make things less confusing in terms of the difference between the closed session and open session. Hopefully this goes part of the way to that point, although I know there's, based on the turnout we had for the closed session public comment, I'd say we with some help from our friends, we succeeded. But there's always room for improvement, so we're going to be doing some other things as well to try to increase our communication. One of them is that we're going to be putting on our website some updates on projects of particular interest to the community, because sometimes a project is discussed and then it seems to disappear into the background for months at a time, and the community thinks nothing's going on, or we're plotting something horrible, you know, behind the scenes or whatever. But we'll try to do periodic updates so that people know what step, even if the update is that there's no update or we're waiting for something from the applicant or we're, you know, scheduling it for planning commission or whatever, but at least you'll know. Another thing that we're going to try to do on the website is put a forecast of when items may be heard on the agenda. I noticed that some other cities do that, and it's very helpful to look at their agendas and say, oh, that's coming up in December, that's coming up in January, and I know I don't have to think about it till then, or I know I can plan my time so I can be there. So we'll be doing that as well. And we're open to other suggestions and ideas. Some came up earlier this evening about other ways that we can improve the communication. We're also talking about maybe a brochure or some sort of little flyer that to encourage public participation and kind of how you do it. So those are some of the things we're thinking about. I will be doing my next mayor's walk on Saturday, December 8th, 9 a.m., meet at Kirsten Court. The subject is up to you, and we'll probably do about a mile walk and work our stamina up to maybe 3 miles uphill, you know. But we're starting off slow. But last time we had a very enjoyable small turnout, but very enjoyable time, and we walked up to the Rose Float Barn and got to talk to everyone there, and I got some really interesting and new suggestions from people about our financial situation. So I encourage you to come to that. I wanted to make a couple of announcements. One is, if you don't know, Karen Schneider delivered her baby on November 17th, and his name is Joseph. He is already home. He came home at 20 inches and 7 pounds, and I know all of us watched Karen grow over the last few months. Unfortunately, the ad hoc committee finished before the baby came, so it was nip and tuck for a while. But anyway, she's doing well. And if you see her around town, she's still on leave, but she'll be coming back soon. The other thing I wanted to mention is that I got a note that I thought was worth sharing, because I didn't know this. The Sierra Madre Civic Club Beautification Committee is who we have to thank for all the lovely Christmas decorations around City Hall. And this is something that they've done for many years, and you know, I kind of took it for granted, so I was very glad that they actually reminded us that this is an activity that they do for the city. And so I think we should all thank them for that. Also want to mention, we'll be talking about Chief Lowe, but as you know, he has announced his retirement. We are going to start, we'll be doing some thanking and celebrating to be announced probably first part of January, our first meeting in January. And then finally, our Chief Diaz has been elected as head of the San Gabriel Valley Police Chiefs Organization. So I think that's, yes. So I think that's something to be proud of as well. So with that, I'll conclude my remarks, and we will come back to the agenda. And we have a couple of presentations to do. And let's see, Bob, would you like to come up and, where are you? There you are. Would you like to come up and we will and do the presentation of the Rose Parade Princesses and Princes?
Sorry about the rerun here.
Yeah. Just, you know, these council members, they don't get it the first time, so.
I don't know where the best place to put this is as far as the camera.
Oh, that's fine.
Is that fine?
Okay.
Robert Young, 195 East Sierra Madre Boulevard, 587 East Sierra Madre Boulevard, which is the address of the Rose Float building. For entertainment purposes, and also because we're so proud of what we're doing, I spoke while you all were taking care of the important things. But we have a beautiful float this year. The theme of the parade is Passport to the World Celebrations. Our theme is Valentine's Day, and I said this already, sorry, not the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. And we have two swans that are 16 and a half feet tall that have our two princesses and two princes or escorts riding in them. Also, it's detailed with seven butterflies that are going to have flapping wings. And that are going to go to 26 feet in height, and we are going to have 90 different varieties of roses, and 300 hearts are going to be on the float. This little, I'm not sure how we could get a good shot of this.
I think he means no,
I'm talking about
the camera.
Is there any place that this could, where the camera
probably
goes?
Probably just hold it in front of the podium.
Yeah, just hold it and they'll kind of...
Oh, that one. Okay.
Yeah, your good side.
There you go. My good side. No, they're both. Now, this is one of the swans, the second swan. And it's 16 and a half feet, and it's made out of pencil rod. The whole float, basically, is supported with pencil rod and that screen that's on top of his head. And this is just the process we are right now. And by the way, if we have any artistic welders around that want to come help, we need some artistic welders. But it's absolutely beautiful what we've come up with here for the design. And more importantly, as I stated previously, very few opportunities exist that you can work together for a common cause that the benefit is building friendships. And that's what it's all about. And we have a ball doing that, and it's fun. And last year we got the Lathrop K. Leishman Award. 2 weeks ago we were here, and Bill Leishman, the son of Lathrop K. Leishman, presented it, and Lathrop K. Leishman's father was instrumental again. He went to Yale and helped with the whole Rose Bowl and was one of the people that made sure it wasn't just the U that they enclosed it. So it was kind of exciting to have that type of, boy, is he a character too. Of course, you can just guess. I got along with him great. the prince and princesses that we have this year are dressed by donated outfits from Attitudes for the Ladies and from the Men's Warehouse. This is not an advertisement, this is a required statement. From Santa Anita Mall and the ladies, which their hair looks wonderful tonight, was done by Carnes for this evening's activities. We have Hannah, Alexandra, Tim, and Andrew, and they were selected out of a group of about 24, 25 people that submitted applications. And they have to be residents of Sierra Madre that go to multiple schools. It doesn't matter where. And we have judges that are not part of Sierra Madre in any way, nor live here. And it's a tough decision, I'll tell you that. I bored them for hours about all the aspects about the Rose Float and how much fun it is and what we do. And so they are going to give us a little talk about who they are, and I will cut my part short because I can go on forever. So, Hannah?
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you for having us here today. My name is Hannah Storley, and I'm 16 years old. I attend Alverno High School, where I'm a junior, and I live on Grandview Avenue with my parents, my 10-year-old sister, our two pugs, Blondie and Blackie, three parakeets, and about 20 fish in our backyard pond. I'm involved in the Drama Club and the Ambassador Club, which represents the best of Alverno at all times. I played volleyball for Alverno my freshman and sophomore years, and in those seasons, I learned a lot about teamwork and self-confidence. Also at my school, I'm taking a video production class. It requires me getting to school at 7 o'clock every morning to prepare the morning announcements and design the show. Every other week, I get to go on TV in front of the whole school. At first, it was scary, but I really benefited from this opportunity. For the past 2 years, I've participated in the Spring Musical at Alverno. Last year, I was a Wickersham brother from Seussical the Musical. I think musicals are a great combination of talent that are a blast to be a part of. Though the practices and rehearsals are time-consuming, the grand outcome is definitely worth the pride of a great performance. Since I was a child, I wanted to play a musical instrument. So, my mom and dad tried to get me into piano lessons. They were going fine until I couldn't play a tisket a tasket a green and yellow basket, so I quit. But don't think I'm a quitter in everything. In seventh grade, I began guitar lessons and I found my skill. It came naturally to me, probably from my dad who taught himself how to play when he was the same age. So now I write my own songs and play guitar too. I have lived in Sierra Madre my whole life. Growing up in the canyon, I always enjoyed walking down to Mary's Market after school to get an ice cream. I remember the Halloween parties at Mary's, trying to bob for apples and pin the tail on the donkey without messing up my homemade fairy costume. My family really enjoyed setting up for Halloween. Though we only got about 3 trick-or-treaters a year, my dad loved to make scary mannequins and put them up in the front yard. 3 years ago, we moved to our new home on Grandview Avenue, where we have the most beautiful view of the city at night. Shortly after moving in, my father was diagnosed with throat cancer. It was a difficult time, but we pulled through it together with love and support. Now he is cancer-free, and we've really learned to appreciate our time together from this scary experience. At this point, I'm not positive about my future plans, but the field I'm most interested in is interior design. The college at the top of my list is FIDM, which stands for Fashion Institute of Design and Merchandising. I think it would be exciting to have a career in set design for television shows or movies. What I love most about this town is its size. It's perfect. There aren't too many people and everyone is so friendly. I'm really proud to live in this all-America city. Not many people can say that nowadays, and I think it's pretty cool. And lastly, I want to express my gratitude to the Sierra Madre Rose Float Association. I'm very much honored to be a representative of our town, and I look forward to fulfilling my duties as princess over the coming months with my new friends, Alexandra, Andrew, and Tim. This is going to be a year to remember. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alexandra Flores, and I'm very happy to be one of the princesses on this year's Sierra Madre Royal Court. I am 17 years old and currently a senior at Maranatha High School in Pasadena. I have enjoyed playing varsity soccer for the past 3 years at my school, and one of my favorite areas to study is life science. On the weekends, you'll probably find me still at my school at one of our athletic events in our cheering section called Code Red. This is due to all the red that all the fans wear to support our teams. This year, I also hold the ASB position of Commissioner of Service. My job is to create and coordinate volunteer opportunities for my fellow students to participate in. I am also a very active member of my church's youth group. I was actually born in Pasadena and lived in the Lower Hastings Ranch area until I was about 8 years old. We then moved here to Sierra Madre because my mother had loved how quaint it was. We built a house on Orange Grove Avenue, but not before the Sierra Madre Fire Department got a hold of our old house and burnt it down as a training session. Many of our friends and family came to watch the house become engulfed with flames, which was kind of exciting. I absolutely love Sierra Madre and the people who make up the town. It has really been a great place for me to grow up in. Everyone is so kind and friendly and willing to give a helping hand, sometimes even two. I feel especially blessed to serve on the Royal Court this year and have the opportunity to meet and interact with so many of the citizens of the town that I treasure. Growing up here, I learned to swim at the rec center. I watched my two younger brothers play baseball at Heasley Field and have been to countless concerts in Memorial Park. I have also been in and watched many 4th of July parades and have always enjoyed the Wisteria Vine festivities and art fairs. Mount Wilson Trail and Bailey Canyon will also be a part of my many memories, as well as the expression, "I'll meet you at Kirsten Court." I feel that living in such a small community like Sierra Madre has helped me determine the type of college I would like to go to and the type of job I would like to have. I would love to go to a small college where my dream would be to become a physical therapist. I decided on physical therapy when I myself had to actually be in it for over a year due to knee injuries. As a physical therapist, you get the opportunity to work one-on-one with people all day and help them regain their strength and confidence. I know that the skills and experiences I take away from being a member of the Royal Court this year and will help me in whatever profession I choose to become. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Timothy Crilly. I am 17 years old, and I am currently a junior at St. Francis High School in La Cañada. I attended St. Rita's Elementary School for 9 years and graduated in 2005. I've lived here in Sierra Madre for 7 years, but have been very active within the city since before I moved into the town, so I've practically grown up in Sierra Madre. My family is very important to me and has been very influential. I'm the youngest of three children and also have three nephews, and I'm proud to be the godfather of my youngest one, which is an honor. I have been involved in the football program at my school for 3 years now and play at the varsity level. I am also involved in the BOCA program at our school, which is Brotherhood of Christian Athletes. It is a service club that allows us to help out the community through tutoring and to participate with other service organizations. Just recently, I worked with the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation at their walk at Dodger Stadium. I'm very active in Sierra Madre in many ways. I'm currently a lifeguard at the pool and have taught swim lessons as well. I'm also part of Boy Scout Troop 110, which is located out of St. Rita's Church. I am the assistant Sierra Patrol leader, and I'm currently working on attaining my Eagle rank. We help out every year at the Art Fair, Wisteria Festival, and the Mount Wilson Trail Race. So we're very active within the city. Sierra Madre has always been important to me because it's a small town where everybody knows everybody, and there's always something to do. No matter what plans I make with my friends on the weekends, we always end up downtown. Sierra Madre is a town that's small in size but large in character, so it's very important to me. My scholastic interests and future plans are to study kinesiology in college. Kinesiology is the study of sports medicine. I'm very interested in the medical field, and lifeguarding has allowed me to learn more about first aid and even more about first response medical care. Being involved in football has also taught me and exposed me to the many types of injuries. I've learned how to treat them and care for them while being in the training room with injuries of my own. So. In the future, I'd like to become paramedic or involved in some other medical field. It's been an honor to be chosen to represent the city of Sierra Madre and the Rose Float Association, and I plan on doing my best to represent the city. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Andrew Peroni, and I am delighted to be here with you this evening. My family moved to Sierra Madre when I was 3. I am the oldest of 5 children, including 2 brothers and 2 sisters. Sharing a room with 2 Lego-obsessed brothers does wear on my bare feet as I step all over the Legos strewn about the floor in the dark. I'm a 17-year-old senior at Pasadena High School, serving as the secretary of the National Honor Society, and have been a member of the California Scholarship Federation for all 4 years, which requires a maintenance of a GPA of 3.0 or above. Additionally, I am the president of the Science Club, treasurer of the Italian Club, and have won the Harvard Book Award, which is a recognition of balance between exceptional academic achievement and extracurricular activities. At the high school, I have been on the swim team for 3 years, where I have won the Most Dedicated Award. And I have also played on the water polo team for 4 years. This year, we finished with 15 wins and 6 losses. If you have heard about the Turkey Tussle, the annual football game between Pasadena and Muir High Schools, and have seen a picture in the Star News, we are the half-painted, red-painted, half-naked, highly spirited spectators. At the school, I have also volunteered my time tutoring and have expanded to helping others outside of my school. In my free time, I enjoy playing piano, hiking to the top of Jones Peak, which can be viewed from the bottom of Auburn, being chased down by bees, and getting a headache from high altitude. I like to read and play baseball in the front yard with my brothers. I also enjoy working in the yard, not the root cutting so much, but the weed pulling is okay. I first became inspired to work in the yard because of a large dirt patch in our backyard. One day we had some extra plants and I fiddled around with them and found I really enjoyed designing and putting together a yard. Today that big patch of dirt now has many rock designs, a path, and almost any plant I can find that grows in the shade and is sold at Target. This leads me in my future plans. I currently am applying to colleges as a landscape architect major. So what inspired me to go into that field? A dirt patch. I attended St. Rita School for 9 years and continue to be involved as an altar server. Also, I have worked with the Sierra Madre Public Library, helping with the youth book sale and the gardens. I have also attended a Rotary Youth Leadership Camp sponsored completely by Rotary International. And I greatly appreciate this opportunity, which has helped me when I work with others, especially in leadership roles. I would like to contribute to our community even after it is needed for college applications and scholarships. And I saw an opportunity to help further through the Rose Float Association. I am honored to be a part of this association and I'm happy that I can give further service to our wonderful community. Thank you.
That's all we have tonight.
Great. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
We have a fine group of young men and women representing us in the parade this year on the Rose Float, and I know that the people building the float are working day and night to get it ready, and we will look for you at the Rose Parade route this year. So thanks very much. Appreciate it. Okay, you're welcome. We have two additional presentations that I'd like to make. The next one is the recognition of our ad hoc committee members, our ad hoc finance committee. And what I'd like to do is I'll come up to the podium and read the names and ask you to come up and join me. As you know, the committee presented its report to us on the last meeting, and we've discussed it thoroughly, and we'll be coming back, I believe, at the next meeting with some decisions regarding revenue measures and so on. But actually, I just thought of it. You know, what I really should do is have the two council representatives who were on the committee do the presentation. So
I'll stand next to you.
Okay. You guys did all the hard work.
They are identical with the exception of different names. What I'm going to do is just read. One, so certificate of recognition, City of Sierra Madre, and it's in recognition of, fill in the name, with appreciation for his dedicated service to the City of Sierra Madre by serving on the Ad Hoc Finance Committee, presented this 27th day of November, 2007, Mayor Jaffe, Mayor Pro Tem Mosca, Council Members Buchanan, Watts, and Zimmerman. And I have previously expressed my appreciation, admiration And never my frustration with my fellow ad hoc council members, and I do so again this evening.
I agree. They put in a lot of effort and poured through a lot of material and came up with some very insightful analysis that really that I moved the process along that was under some difficult time constraints. And if you know who they are and you see them, thank them for their service, because it was very helpful to all of us in this community, I think we'll find.
Is Mike Comer here this evening? I'll hold that for Mike. Scott Hood. Thank you very much, Scott.
I'm going to stand or wait.
Go next.
Oh, we're going to alternate. Okay. George and Yeti. George here? Ah, there you are. Thank you, George.
Thank you very, very much.
If I may say just a couple of few words, I would like to thank you all for choosing us, being members of the ad hoc committee and placing your confidence in us. And I would like to thank the city managers, Elaine Aguilar, and staff, Karen Schneider and Bruce Inman, for the valuable information that they provided, which ultimately enabled us to make our decision. And also to our loyal audience, spearheaded by Faye Angus, and for the valuable input. I thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dennis Keegan. Dennis, good to see you. I'll have to hold that.
And Tom Jansen. Tom, are you here?
I didn't think I saw you, but I asked him.
And I've got one more.
Do I?
Yes. Richard Mays, our city treasurer. I would think he'd just love to attend these meetings, but I guess not. But when you know Dick, when you see him, he does a lot of good work for this city, and this is just one more example of that. So give him a pat on the back when you see him. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have one other presentation from Dave Ford, Southern California Edison, who I think has some good news to tell us.
To the mayor, council members, and city manager, and as well as stakeholders in the community. It's a real pleasure for us to be here this evening. Must be waking up too late. Holly Bennett is here with me today, and she has worked with the city over the past year or so in presenting energy efficiency programs to help the city reduce costs and upgrade their efficiencies of various types of in-using equipment within the city. I'm going to let Holly introduce herself, as well as she's going to call upon some people from the city, the mayor, and I'm sure Public Works Director, to make this special presentation on behalf of Southern California Edison to the city.
Hello, Council. Holly Bennett, Southern California Edison, account executive for the City of Sierra Madre. I just want to take a moment to congratulate you and your staff on the hard work that they're taking, the steps to really utilize our programs and take advantage of energy efficiency. If I could have Mayor Jaffe and Director of Public Works, Bruce Inman, please come up.
$1,577.36 as a result of an upgrade you did on one of your wells, and that is resulting in an annual kilowatt hour savings of 144,000 kilowatt hours a year. So, quite an accomplishment to you and your staff and to Mayor and Council. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
if I recall, we've only just begun.
That's
yes.
Right.
There should be another one to come
more.
That's
where
it's working
out.
The community, the staff here, just for the community to know, is really taking efforts to try to make Sierra Madre a green community. So you should applaud them. They're doing a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Yes, I have one other presentation I'd like to make, and this was made to the Friends of the Sierra Madre Library. I've gotten a call earlier.
So Tony, come up.
Actually, about 2 weeks ago, and I'm going to ask Tony Buckner to come up, who is the Director of Library Services. Timing was everything on this. Contribution from Southern California Edison, because I just happened to mention it in conversation. I wanted to do something for Sierra Madre in a conference call that morning, and then I think her name's Patty Murphy had called me and says, Dave, you know, we had a conversation earlier, and were you able to do anything for the library? And I said, well, you know, as a matter of fact, I just got off of the phone call, and I need you to send me your 501c3 letter and asking for a contribution by 11 o'clock today. So, and I wasn't in my office, so it was all coordinated with my staff, and it, on behalf of Southern California Edison. And I'd just like to thank the mayor for identifying the need for us to support the library. And we enjoy doing this in the community. I think it's a wonderful thing of service that we are committed to helping a library extend and expand its operations. And being a friend of the library, we want to present this check to Tony on behalf of Southern California.
Thank you very, very
much.
Thank you. I have one other. Oh, you wanted to say something. I'm sorry.
No, I just wanted to say on behalf of the Friends of the Library, we appreciate Southern California's Edison's generous gift. Thank you.
Thank you. Also, I know that the city's always trying to find ways to save money and save energy at the same time, and I understand that y'all are going to be putting up a new Christmas tree in City Hall soon. I brought some LED Christmas lights. These are very energy efficient lamps. As a sample of these, there's about 100 lights, and compared to regular Christmas tree lights, these are 9 watts, all the lamps together, compared to a 40 watt string of Christmas tree lights, and they're very safe, and they will probably last beyond my lifetime in Edison. So you're welcome to put these on the tree as a gift from Edison and the lighting company that provided those.
Thank you very much.
You.
Now I feel like we're really going to have a good time.
Dave has been very, very supportive of the community, and we very much appreciate the things that Edison has done and continues to do. And they've also been supporting the Chamber of Commerce, and as we saw, the library. And as we get more energy efficiency improvements in City Hall, we hope to collect more of that rebate, so rebate money. Thank you again. Appreciate it. All right, well, we're finally at the point in the agenda for public comment on items not on the agenda. So are there any members of the audience who would like to come to the podium and comment on things not on the agenda?
Caroline Brown, 680 Alta Vista Drive. I want to caution you when it comes to city property and way in which decisions might be made about what to do with property if it's not deemed usable the way it was initially thought out through earlier city councils. Because it came to my attention here just the other day that the fire station in the canyon was seen online on either eBay or Craigslist as being for sale for $650,000. That would have given these two young men who were enthusiastically in front of us saying that they wanted to put an art studio for themselves to use in the canyon within our neighborhood. Right now it's currently being rented to another artist. We don't know who that person is. So the neighbors around there are concerned because art materials differ from art medium to art medium, and the question was asked of these two original purchasers, you know, what types of materials they were going to be working with, what types of noise would be generated, and so on and so forth. So likewise, when you look at other pieces of property in town, such as the park, at some point then, when it is sold, there is no more control over it. It becomes privately owned by whomever has it. When the senior housing was first sited, where it was down on, I'm losing the name of the street.
Esperanza.
The idea was that it was within walking distance of a community market. But there again, it's a private piece of property that, as it remaining a community market, we had no control over that. And yet, the concept of where to put the senior housing was such that people could walk to a community market because seniors were considered probably less going to be driving their own vehicles over time. It also brings me back to something else. I think I'm not going to really remember the date, but when the city determined that they would pass an ordinance for no drive-through business establishments. I think, Enid, you might have been on the Planning Commission at the time. And by the time the ordinance was written by the city of Sierra Madre, I Enjoy Bagels was out of business. That franchise ceased to exist. So there we were, thinking we might have a nice business in town at such and such a place, and yet we would have had absolutely no control over the future of how that drive-through property would have been used, because I Enjoy Bagels went out of business. Actually, I think they turned into another business, something like a pizza joint of some sort, another pizza franchise, which in fact was owned by Boston Markets, which in fact is underneath Colonel Sanders. So the lengths at which this stuff sort of goes away from our control when we do sell it or do allow for uses that may not be in our best interest is, I think, of great concern to the citizens of Sierra Madre. And we want to see that our elected city officials make wise decisions in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you. Other comments?
Marianne McGillivray, Elm Avenue. I actually stopped by this evening just to see if any of you had taken any action on my suggestion a couple of weeks ago to take a look up at what's going on at One Carter. From a variety of vantage points in the city, you could have looked from the boulevard, you could have gone up closer. It's very obvious what is going on up there, and this may be sort of a warm-up for our friends here for the Stonehouse situation. But and if you didn't go up there, I would encourage you again to go up and take a look, because the road is directly on top of the Western Ridge Line, and the way it is being constructed at this time, if a vehicle were to get a little out of control at one point, it would probably fall right down through the roof of Tara Willis's house. So that leads one to think that, well, of course, we're going to have to put up a significant guardrail so that that won't happen, and that guardrail will probably be seen all the way from Tijuana. So the other part of that problem is that that road that is on that ridge line is leading up to lots 3, 4, and 7 and others, and there doesn't seem to be a reason to be building a road going up to areas unless those areas are intended building sites. Now, I understand that the building sites and the homes and so on aren't being approved. It's just the grading. The point being, though, once the grading is there and it sort of becomes the building site, now the buildings that are built there are subject to the new hillside ordinance. There is absolutely no way that a building can be built on those sites that will meet the criteria of the hillside ordinance. So, you know, you've got the situation here where you have one activity going on that's going to absolutely preclude following the law of the next activity. So they're not isolated events, they're related. And this is the time to be looking at the first event so that we can ward off what's going to happen at the second event, because what we'll be faced with then is more compromise. The compromises that were made for One Carter, the compromises that were made by this legislative body were compromises that were made for probably a multiple of reasons, many of which were legal, but none of which were supported by the community. Now we have the Hillside Ordinance that we spent an inordinate, not an inordinate, but a very large amount of time, and John certainly knows, and Sandy certainly knows, and Kurt from time to time was there, and we labored over this, and came up with a set of rules that we could all live by that would meet the needs of the community, but those rules are going to have to be compromised if we don't take action now. So I'll bring up the comment I made 2 weeks ago. Compromises lead to consequences. And we are already seeing the consequences of the first compromise. So how many more consequences will we have as we move forward, because these two events cannot, they are not compatible, they are not congruent. And it's time to go up there and take a look. I will suggest again that it would be appropriate for the inspector to be meeting on a regular basis with whatever members of the Hillside Task Force and staff would be available, because I think the inspector right now is focusing on the current grading and the grading only, without any foresight to what's going to be built. And quite frankly, it appears to me they're probably exceeding it. It seems that they've got to be exceeding the grading limits that have been called out for. But again, that's something that I think that if we were working with as more of a community, we would have less consequences as a result of these compromises. And I don't think that the inspector up there right now is at all looking forward to what's going to be built. That's not his purview right now. So again, I will encourage you, you know, about a month ago, there was a conversation on the council about a building on Lowell. There was going to be a teardown of a single family dwelling. It was on the corner of Lowell and something, and the proposed replacement were two buildings of two stories. And there was some discussion about, you know, the privacy, looking into other properties and so on. And it was a very good discussion, and it was very well taken, and it was very well intended. And when I think back to the length of that conversation and the concern we had for that corner piece of property and that effect it might have on its neighbor, the effect that One Carter is having on this entire community is much larger than that. And there are not a lot of conversations going on about that. Whatever the legal parameters are, you know what they are. But, you know, as they always say about lawyers, and you who are them know, it just takes time and money. It might be a good time for Sandy and for Ms. Watson, Ms. Teagarden, whoever needs to be involved in this, to start talking about what is going on up there and how we are going to meet the requirements of the ordinance when it comes time to build on those lots. It's not too late to move the bulldozer now, but it will be later. And as an aside to that, I don't know what provisions can be made for surrounding areas. I can tell you that the crashing and the banging is pretty severe. I don't know whether it's because of the large equipment, but, you know, even my house shakes from time to time, and I'm a considerable distance from it, so I can imagine that anybody closer would be getting the brunt of that. And I don't know whether there can be any provision made should there be any major damage, but that's something that ought to be talked about too. At any rate, compromise leads to consequence, so go up there and take a look. I think you'll be very surprised at what you see. It is significantly and I would have to honestly say adversely changed the property up there and will affect the entire city. Thanks.
Thank you. Marianne, I didn't want to interrupt you, but I think that we are going to be discussing the whole stone house, which relates to One Carter, a little bit later in the agenda. So we'll take your remarks under advisement at that point in time. Okay, thanks.
Laurie Cooper, 505 East Laurel. I'm still quite disturbed about this prospective advisory statement that goes on. I know election is quite a long way, so it hasn't even been put down in black and white. But in discussing with other people, this one of the things that came out is for a lot of people, safety is not number one priority, but it is in the mix of, depending on where you are, for some, the youth activities and recreation area is the top priority. For others, it's the senior citizen. For many, it's open space and parks. And while safety is certainly a part of the whole thing, I don't think it's the only thing. And in the advisory statement, I gather that the idea is to say that you advise them to, if they don't pass it, you won't have the funds to pay the police. And I'm not against the police. I think they have done a wonderful job, and I think the police chief is something the best thing that ever happened to us. But there are so many things that make Sierra Madre what it is that need money too. So if you had an advisory, I'd say, hey, if we don't get X amount of money in new taxes, then these are the departments that will be affected. The police take so much, the firemen take so much, the library takes so much, the senior citizen, the whatever it is that comes out of the general fund, they will be affected by loss of revenue if you don't pass the tax. And I think if people thought that a general need, it would probably pass. If it's going to be very specific, I don't know. Anyway, I think that people need to be better informed, and in writing it up, I think you have to kind of tell them, get out and vote, but don't tell them how to vote. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will be discussing the proposal and advisory measure on our December 11th meeting. So for anyone who's interested in it, please plan to attend that and comment. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me. Heather Allen, I live on Grove Street. I had a couple of things I wanted to mention. The first was a question in regards to the agenda. I noticed that in the open agenda, there's no approval of the minutes tonight. Can anyone tell me what happened to the minutes?
There aren't any minutes ready to be approved yet.
Do you know when they'll be ready?
Hopefully by the next meeting we'll have some minutes on there.
Okay. And for the benefit of people who weren't here earlier, making sure I got it straight, the minutes are going to be taken from the videos. Is that right? For the most part?
For the most part, well, the first draft of the minutes is going to be prepared based upon the tape, but I review them, as people will notice, I'm constantly writing, mm-hmm. because I review them to make sure that they accurately reflect what happened
from a
person who was here perspective.
Okay, and if there isn't any if it isn't filmed for that meeting, you're taking the minutes, is that right? Great, now I understand, thank you. The other thing I wanted to mention is, as Ms. Jaffe brought up, I'm speaking mostly for the people at home, for anyone that might have come in late, there is a new format for the agenda, and it lists both the closed session and open session, one at 5:30, the other at 6:30. And what I wanted to mention is that there might be people in town that don't know you can come and speak for the closed sessions. And it has its own item on the agenda right after the roll call, and you can come and speak on an item during the closed session, which is something that maybe people don't know. For anyone who wasn't able to attend tonight's meeting, it was rather surprising. We had 22 people in the audience coming to oppose the sale or lease of what happened at Howie's. I should say the Howie's parking lot. The city owns a piece of parking lot behind Howie's, and people came out to voice their opinions, and several people spoke. It was really interesting. And I mentioned this earlier, but I wanted to say it again for the benefit of the people at home, that it's unfortunate it wasn't televised, because I feel that the community has a right to know what's going on, and I hope that they will film them in the future. And that pretty much sums up what I had to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Good evening. My name is Pete Salter, and thank you for this time. And I wanted to take us back to the theme that we started with earlier on the Rose Parade. I'm here tonight as a parent representing the Pasadena Unified School District All-Star Band. And we think that we're going to do our best to epitomize the theme, Passports to Distant Land, to the World Celebrations, by not marching in the Rose Parade this year, but marching instead in the London Lord Mayor's New Year's Day Parade and Festival. And thank you. And so what I was here tonight to mention, and I have flyers for you guys up here, is our last fundraising event that we are going to be holding before we leave on December 27th is a Bon Voyage benefit concert featuring Billy Childs, who's a Grammy Award-winning jazz chamber artist, and his group. And it'll also be our last U.S. performance before we leave. So I'd like to personally invite the Sierra Madre community to our concert. It's December 15th in the Pasadena Unified, our Pasadena High School Auditorium. Tickets are $15 for students and $30 for adults. And it starts at 7 p.m. on that December 15th. We'll also have refreshments and all that kind of stuff. If you're interested in going, tickets will be available at the door. And you can also call me at 578-1127 to order tickets, or email me at psoelter, S-O-E-L-T-E-R, at earthlink.net, and I'll mail you tickets. You can also order tickets at another number, 818-802-2111. The cost of this trip is about $245,000, and we've raised about $50,000 in donations and grants and gifts from various organizations in the community. And we've also raised another $185,000 through our own fundraising efforts and parent contributions. So we're only about $10,000 short at this point. So we're hoping that this concert will put us over the top, and we think it's going to be a great evening. And I'll leave a flyer in the back, and I'll pass, give these out to you guys. I just want to thank you for your time. It was a great night to come. Rose princesses and prince escorts were very articulate, and I really enjoyed hearing them. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, and good luck.
Thank you.
I just wanted to reemphasize what Pete's talking about. It really is a big deal what's happening with the Pasadena Unified School District All-Star Band. So if you can give them the help, it's a very worthy cause.
Oh, good. I just want to mention, we actually have 105 people going. We have 91 musicians, four instructors and coaches, and I think that leaves 10 parents as chaperones. So we're sending 105 people, which is, for us, quite an accomplishment. About 40% of our kids are on free and reduced lunch, and so we're doing our best to make sure that we don't leave anybody behind. Thank you.
Fabulous. Thank you.
And we did pass a resolution actually supporting this too.
I forgot everything.
I wanted to thank you for that, and I forgot to do that. You guys were actually one of the first. Back in the spring, our first effort was to get resolutions from our city and school district elected officials, and Sierra Madre was one of the first to come through, and we really, really appreciate that. It really set the tone for us, and those are the kinds of things that give the parents the boost to go out and do the effort. So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thanks again. Faye Angus Cannon Drive, bravo to the band. I'm sure they'll have a marvelous trip, God Save the Queen and all that sort of jazz.
I think you should go as a chaperone.
I really would love to.
You've got the accent.
As a matter of fact, you know, to jive things up here, I don't know why you don't appoint me as the hostess officiato or something and let me serve tea in the lobby before these meetings. Exactly.
Wait, until you're mayor.
There you go, tea and crumpets. I do think the city should consider talking to Nancy Schulenberger about taking the minutes. She is the city clerk, and for years and years and years, she did take the minutes. I don't know what the procedure is, but I did have a conversation with her a couple of weeks ago and asked if she would be available and willing, and she seemed to be very sensitive to the financial crunch that the city's in right now, and I think she would respond very generously with her time. So you may want to consider that. I also want to thank Councilmember Zimmerman's moment of silence for the fact that no lives were lost in the Malibu fire. And our hearts go out to those who did lose their homes and went through the trauma, because we've had these fires in Kinaloa Ranch and along our foothills for many years. And I did want to tell you that I attended a remarkable demonstration by Mike Kinney and our fire marshal, Rich Snyder, up in the canyon a Sunday or so ago, where they demonstrated the use of a fire-resistant gel.
And it was quite extraordinary that they could burn a piece of wood and with a gel on it, it didn't catch fire. And I learned so much that I didn't know. For example, that the heat breaks the windows, and very often that's the cause of the flames going in. And with this gel that you mix with water with your garden hose, it's quite easily applied, you can prevent all of that. And when you see the firefighters with their great big huge packs on their back, they're carrying 80 pounds of that type of a gel when they fight a fire. And I think it would be very worthwhile for the whole community to be able to see this. I realize you can't bring a blowtorch into the council chambers, but perhaps Mike Kinney could have a video and the fire marshal could do a little presentation that could go over the television at one of our council meetings so that the whole community could respond to that. Several of our neighbors up on Cannon Drive and around the corner up the canyon purchased the gel, and it's quite expensive, I might say, but I feel it's a very worthwhile investment because it did save homes down in Malibu, and especially of anyone living above Grandview Avenue on the slopes there. If neighborhoods would band together and neighbors agree to help each other and they had this gel on hand, I think it would be very effective in hindering the fire from coming in to the community, and especially with the Santa Ana wind season that we have on us now. So I'd very much appreciate it if you could invite them to come here and give that type of a demonstration. It would be very, very worthwhile. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a good suggestion. I was actually talking to someone at the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy meeting who had attended the demonstration from another city and was most impressed with the product. So, other comments? Okay, then we'll bring it back to the council, and our next action is to approve the warrants. So, Councilmember Zimmerman.
Reading the warrants, ratification of resolution number 07-091, a resolution to approve payment of city warrants numbers 19077, 19078, 19184 in the aggregate amount of $381,828.81. Sierra Madre Library warrants number 19192 to 19205 in the aggregate amount of $6,721.13, and payroll transfer in the aggregate amount of $273,441.04 for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2008.
And is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any other discussion or questions? Any comments from the audience? On the warrants? Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye, with the exception of warrant number 19161, on which I abstain because it pays my employer, Southern California Edison.
Okay. Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, we now have the consent calendar, and I'll turn to the city manager.
Madam Mayor, there are only two items on the consent calendar this evening. The first one is a recommendation to accept and file the Treasurer's Report for October 2002. Item B is a recommendation to accept and file the Financial Report for October 2007. That concludes my report.
Okay, any questions about the Financial Report? I had one. The water treatment for $345,000 that's noted as, you know, as a major activity, is that using our new water treatment facility, or is that startup, or anybody tell me what that is?
Bruce Sidman, the Public Works Director, can answer that question.
That number is the final payment. That's the payment of retention on the construction of that project.
Okay. Great. Thank you. All right. There are no other questions or comments? Does anybody want to make a motion to approve the consent calendar?
I'll move the consent calendar.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any other discussion?
Anybody in the audience?
Anybody in the audience like to comment? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, the next item is a report on the Auxiliary Firefighter Program. And Chief Lowe's One of your last official acts.
Yes. Good evening, Mayor Jaffe and members of the City Council. It's my pleasure to give you a status report on the auxiliary firefighting program, which indeed also is a volunteer program, a non-paying program. To refresh your memory, it is to augment our current staff of volunteers with a number of firefighters that have either the Firefighter 1 certificate already in place, or have graduated from an accredited fire academy, or participate in our 18-week in-house academy. It is our anticipated goal that these firefighters would augment particularly the daytime manning power to a minimum level. We would have the first implementation level of the program would have two auxiliary firefighters on board on a 24-hour shift. One would be placed on an engine and one would be placed on a rescue, where they would, the main goal is to help our staffing during the daytime, Monday through Friday. The second phase would be, that first phase we hope to implement on February the 1st. The second phase would add additional auxiliaries to fill in the weekend duties also. We hope to implement that on July the 1st of 08. It also brings forward to our membership the fact that they will all be EMT-1s. They will also have an ambulance driver's licenses, a Class B driver's license within the first 6 months of their hire. And other minimum requirements such as high school equivalency diplomas and so on. So we hope it is to implement that very soon. We've already, up to date, have had three sessions, and I call a session a informational meeting, an interview as part of the hiring process, as well as a participation in a physical agility test. To date, we've had 75 people respond to the position. We have 52 who have actually attended the recruitment informational meetings. 35 people have attended the oral interviews. 31 people have attended the physical agility tests. 28 people are currently going through the background check and the other associated examinations by the city. 12 people have Fire Academy and EMT experience. 4 people have Fire Academy experience only. 15 people have EMT experience only. And 4 people have no experience at all. We hope to have final offers to those positions no later than the 15th of December. We hope to start the mini academy on January 12th, ending on January 20th, and a full academy starting on February the 2nd, ending on June the 1st. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Any questions for Chief Love?
Chief, the mini academy, where is that being conducted through the training programs that we have, or is this going to be in-house here?
It's in-house.
So that's, and the mini academy consists just basically of what exactly?
Actually, it's basically a screening process as well as an informational process of how the fire department operates, what their expectations should be, what the requirements of being a, further to inform on what their requirements will be as a member.
Okay, so it's sort of an orientation to our particular situation here in the city.
Correct.
Okay.
Because we are so unique, so.
No, I'm a big fan of this program, and I know it's going to require a lot of recruiting effort in the future to replenish these members who come in and get their experience, but it's the way we we get people in the doors, we offer them the kind of training that they are going to need to become full-fledged firefighters rather than just academy training, and
correct.
We get the benefit of their services to help us out, and I think that's a great idea. Are there any limits that we have been made aware of with respect to our participation in Area C or mutual aid agreements that are in any way affected by the use of auxiliary firefighters, or is that pretty much that gets a clean bill of health from our partners?
It pretty much is a clean bill of health. It's auxiliary programs are nothing new in the industry, if you will. Currently, it's diminishing a little bit with the other partner cities. However, it's something that is certainly not new. And in fact, most of the other departments use that as a recruitment process almost exclusively. So things have changed in the to the current way that fire departments recruit. I think the numbers of people applying are down from probably a decade and a half or two decades ago. Certainly what affects us as well as other departments, smaller departments, is what happens in LA City and what happens with LA County being the largest employers of firefighters in the area. So that will continue to move. One of the areas that we're seeing a difference is in our ability to recruit paramedics. So that's getting a little more difficult than it was when we initially started the program. So.
Thanks.
Chief, so the goal of instituting this program is to augment the department by two firefighters during the week, and that's phase two. Is that the ultimate goal long term?
The ultimate goal is to have two auxiliaries every day.
Every day.
24 hours a day.
All
right. It's a little bit different than our mainstream firefighter. Well, there's another somewhat requirement too. It expands the distance that you live from the city. An auxiliary can live farther away than a firefighter that's a regular firefighter, if you will.
But during the weekday, it's basically we're looking to augment by two firefighters.
Correct.
And then during the weekend, we're looking for how many more?
It'll be the same thing. Basically,
so
at the end of the program, we want two auxiliaries per day.
All right. So it's all right. And then, as Councilman Buchanan said, that just the recruiting we're seeing now with the paramedics that there it's getting tighter in the market, and perhaps it's going to be just as tight for auxiliary firefighters. Who's going to be doing the recruiting?
Well, we have it in within the department as well as human resources.
Because we've hired a specific person for the paramedic coordinator who actually recruits for the paramedics. Is there somebody other than that person that would be recruiting for the?
Actually, we have two people. Again, Captain Greg Christmas is helping in that effort with the auxiliaries, as well as Jim Moran. So Jim Moran is our official recruitment person,
right.
And he's helping with this recruitment effort also.
Within the financial review of our memo, it says that there's a possibility of an increase in workers' compensation. Why is there a possibility of increase in workers' compensation?
I'm not sure.
All right. Do we know, does anybody know what the potential is and why there's a potential?
Yes, Councilmember Muska, there's a potential, but it will depend on the history of injuries and things that happen and how it affects the rates we pay, et cetera. So it's almost impossible to estimate what it will be. But we do have to pay workers' comp on volunteers. And so it's a difficult number to come up with an estimate.
Beyond the potential for workers' compensation, and then there's the $2,700 fee that is assigned to screening for each recruit that we're looking at. What other costs? Because it says it doesn't have any cost, but I'm just kind of thinking about this now, and I would imagine that there's staff that needs to focus on this. So are we going to be looking at hiring more personnel to do this?
The major portion of that cost is probably the personal protective equipment that firefighters have to have. A lot of that equipment just is not available off the shelf. in standard sizes.
Right.
They have to fit a certain way. They can't be too loose. They can't be too tight. And
so that's within the $2,700. That's not just. That's not
correct.
Just all right.
In addition to that, it is going to be. We are going to be able to pay that within the current budget. And the reason is we are budgeted for X number of firefighters, of which we are not up to that level of manning at this time.
All right.
So we're budgeted to more people than we have.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments? Actually, I had one, Chief Lowe. What's the total number of auxiliary firefighters we would like to have ultimately?
We would have 14 in total is what we would like to do. They would be required, as I said, a 24-hour shift, one day a week is what our target is.
And how, if a auxiliary firefighter is doing this to meet his requirement of hours of experience, how many hours are they required to have? How long will we have them for, probably?
Their requirement is a year on a fire department.
Okay.
Exactly as what you're looking towards is a person who's graduated from an accredited fire academy is not awarded their certificate until they have a one-year experience level with the fire department.
Is there the potential that even once they move on, they could still stay with the department as probably not as a volunteer firefighter because they might not live in the city, but as an auxiliary? Would that be a possibility?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Sure. Because our requirements include a person who already has a certificate. There are a certain number of people out there with a certificate, but do not have a career position yet.
Very good. All right, thank you.
People should understand that, and I mean many already do if they follow this issue, but one of the critical issues that we've been confronted with is how do we continue particularly daytime response and do it in a timely fashion. And when you're dealing with a volunteer fire department, you have to do it in sort of innovative ways, especially in an urban environment, and ours counts as an urban fire department. So the reason we go through these things is so that we can assure we will have an adequate staffing level when the alarm goes off, basically.
Excellent.
And that's the biggest problem with that is daytime, weekday response.
Okay, very good. All right, don't go too far because we might need you on the next item. So this is a receive and file item, so we don't need a motion. But the next item is the public hearing to approve for the second reading of the fire code adoption. We already... Did I miss something?
I think this does require approval of ask for approval of the firefighter auxiliary program, although I thought we'd already had that.
That's a recommendation to receive and file.
Oh, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm looking at the alternatives.
Never mind. Staff report, correct.
Never mind. I'm looking at the rest.
Any auxiliary firefighter?
Okay. Right. Mayor Pro Tem Mosca reminded me that I hadn't asked if there was any public input on the auxiliary firefighter program before we move on? And we do.
Caroline Brown, 680 Alta Vista Drive. I just want to support the work that goes on in our city for fire suppression and how important it is at all its various layers. Last night, I was representing the city of Sierra Madre at the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy. I'm on the advisory board. And we were in Malibu Canyon, and there were many residents from the Malibu area that was still putting out some spot fires who were there because of some concerns that where the fire started. And it started on state public lands. It's a very interesting mix of public and private usage in the Santa Monica Mountains. But because of the work that we had accomplished here in Sierra Madre with the Fire Safe Council as a sort of support to the work of the city, I made a presentation because I knew that Malibu does not have a Fire Safe Council. Topanga Canyon has had an arson watch for years, but that's because they're really in the county and they're this small kind of enclave out there. They work at a different rate. So while I commented about the efforts of the Sierra Madre Fire Safe Council the president of the board, who used to live in Sierra Madre, by the way, Elizabeth Cheadle, looked over at me and she says, "And you still have a volunteer fire department, don't you, in Sierra Madre?" And I said, "Yes, and it is the last one in Los Angeles County." So a large number of people at this meeting last night got a nice promotional piece of information about Sierra Madre and its volunteer fire department and the work of the Fire Safe Council. And just to add to that tonight, there will be at 3 a.m. a red flag warning called. It will go until 6 p.m. Signs will go up again to close down the access to the open space in the foothills. So far, it has worked out very well from the standpoint of public's response. The public understands when the explanation is given to them in a reasonable way, and the other important piece of that is when the fire hazard passes, then the trails are open to them again, and they're very responsive. Thank you.
Caroline, do you want to give a plug for the volunteers? I know you asked for to help with fire warnings.
Well, we do have the red flag alert patrol group. Richard Snyder has put us through one training session. We are trying to schedule with his busy schedule another training session. I've still been trying to work up the protocol books, and every time I'm sitting down ready to do it, there's a red flag patrol, red flag warning call, and sort of, you know, things do get sidetracked, and then you try to get back on target. Yes, we have good response from people, people that are sometimes only catching their emails, though, when they get to work on Monday, and the red flag warning went up Saturday morning or something like that. So communicating with people is tricky. So they may call. Anyone within the sound of my voice will call Mike Kinney at 355-0741, which is the phone number for the Sierra Madre Fire Safe Council. 355, I have to see it on the 0741.
And it also might be something, I know we do post, I guess I'm on your email list, but we could post it maybe on the city email blast as well, because it is obviously a city safety issue.
People asked me about that when they came to the trailhead. Could they look online and see whether the trails were open?
I thought we could.
And I directed them to call the police department, because they're the ones that call me to put the signs back out. And I was just not really sure if they would expect to find an update there, because if it starts at 6 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday, I don't think anybody's here updating it, so that's not going to happen. So again, I just think calling the police department, the desk officer, is going to tell them whether it's in effect or not, because people are coming to hike these trails from all over Southern California.
Right. Yeah. But I've had people say, "Well, why aren't you closing the trails?" And I said, "We are." So I think they very much appreciate that. Okay, Tony, did you want to comment?
Assistant Chief Heidorf, he sends an email to me, and also the weather link goes directly to the national weather site that includes the warnings, and so you can get that online. And whenever there is a red flag warning, all trails are closed. It doesn't, I haven't put into the text that the trails are closed, but the text does include the red flag warning on the website on the homepage.
Oh, good. Okay, thank you. Okay, so any other comment on the firefighter volunteer program, the auxiliary program? Not, we will move on to the fire code adoption. We had first reading at the last meeting, so this is second reading, and Madam City Manager, if you would like to comment.
Staff is prepared to do the full entire staff report on this item was presented at your last meeting. Our fire marshal, Richard Snyder, is here this evening. If you would like a brief staff presentation before accepting public comment and adopting second reading. So it would be at your pleasure.
All right. Maybe we could well, since we do have folks here, maybe we could ask Rick to come up and briefly tell us what we're adopting once more.
Good evening. There's quite a few more people this time.
Mm-hmm.
It's not 11 o'clock at night. At its meeting of November 13, 2007, the City Council conducted a public hearing to consider the adoption of Ordinance Number 1272, an ordinance of the City of Sierra Madre amending Title 1524 of the Sierra Madre Municipal Code, adopting the 2006 International Fire Code and the 2007 California Fire Code with amendments. The new state fire code takes into effect January 1st, 2008. Ordinance 1272 makes local amendments to those codes for local adoption to be applied in Sierra Madre. There's really no significant changes in the new codes from the uniform codes that we've previously adopted, and it's staff's recommendation to open the public hearing and hold a public hearing to review the ordinance and take public comment. I will review from my last report. I'm going to go ahead and read my report from last time since we didn't have people here before. Currently, the city is operating under the 2001 California Fire Code and 2000 Uniform Fire Code. The 2000 code is a big change for the state because we've moved away from the uniform codes and now switching over to the international codes. One of the biggest challenges with the new code is getting used to the new format and the code numbers. The state adopted this international code in July of this year, and again, it will become effective in January 2008. Again, the ordinance before you is just local amendments to that code. So I'm here if you have any questions.
Very good. Are there any questions of Rick before I open the public hearing? All right, then I'm going to go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to speak regarding this item? Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and take it back to the council. And any comments, thoughts?
I'm going to move that we approve ordinance number 1272. I'll read it for the first time, for the second time. It is amending Title 1524 of the Sierra Madre Municipal Code relating to the adoption and amendment of the 2006 International Fire Code, the 2007 California Fire Code.
Second.
With amendments.
And second. Waive further reading.
And waive further reading.
And I still second it. Yeah.
Moved and seconded. Any other discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay, so we've got our new fire code in place. Thank you. And next on to item 5, which is actually the first reading for adoption of the new building code. And it looks like Ann is going to be making that report.
Good evening, council members. This is a similar type of action that you'll be taking, but in this case regarding the adoption of the California Building Standards Code. And for the sake of the folks that are in the audience, the staff report actually will probably answer most of your questions and the audience's questions, and it's very brief, so I'll just repeat what it says in your written report in a slightly different order than it's in here. The California Building Standards Commission is responsible for the adoption of the latest model codes every 3 years. After review and input by various state agencies and other interested parties, public hearings are held by that commission, and it ultimately amends and adopts the selected model codes under the title California Building Standards Code. And absent a local ordinance adopting and amending that document, the California Building Standards Code, that document would automatically become effective for our city on January 1st, 2008, without amendments. So if the city is to retain local amendments deemed important to the health, safety, and welfare of Sierra Madre residents and visitors, and I'll give you some examples in a moment, we need to adopt this ordinance with the amendments. The attached ordinance provides for the adoption of the latest edition of that code, and it encompasses building, mechanical, plumbing, energy, electrical, and fire code, and readopts many of the city amendments currently in place. The California Health and Safety Code allows cities to amend this document when deemed necessary and reasonable because of local climate, geological, topographical conditions, as long as the amendments, and this is very important, are more restrictive than the unamended code. So what you're doing tonight is you'll be adopting the California building standards code or holding a first reading on it with amendments that are more restrictive than what the state requires. In addition, the new code additions numbering system compel us to renumber some of our code sections in our ordinance. Another aspect of this is that the Los Angeles Regional Uniform Code Program is attached to your ordinance as an exhibit, and we're also asking that you adopt this. It is prepared by a group called the International Code Council Los Angeles Basin Chapter. This group also met and reviewed different types of code issues that are particularly of interest or sensitivity to cities in the Los Angeles region, and so it contains a number of structural modifications to the California code, again, that are more restrictive and more protective of our residents' safety here in Sierra Madre. I also just want to point out the nature of some of the types of amendments that you see in here. In your staff report, it refers generally to fire sprinklers, Class A non-wood roof, higher seismic standards. If you glance through the ordinance, some of the other things are how we determine replacement value of structures. It allows us to adopt our own fees rather than having to impose the California fees. It allows us to have special requirements for the demolition of historic structures, which we know is sensitive here. Again, adopting this Los Angeles regional document. What are some of the others? Our provisions for sewage backflow when sewers are required. All of these amendments the city has discussed and adopted over time end up becoming adopted and readopted in this version of the ordinance. I want to make something really clear also, because people might be confused about this. This does not affect our zoning ordinance. This doesn't have anything to do with how we, our laws that govern height, massing, density, the use of properties. This is really only regarding structures and structural issues that are raised when projects are submitted for plan check. That all of that said, I'm happy to answer questions with the caveat that I'm not your building official. I'm not a building inspector, and I don't have any particular expertise in the technical parts of this. But if you have any questions about the process or why we're doing this at this time, I can try to answer your questions. If you have any questions I can't answer, I can certainly include the answers to those in your next when you have your second reading of the ordinance before you make your final adoption.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any questions for Ann?
There were a couple of things I was trying to assure myself of, but wasn't able to do so as I was reading through this. And I think I know the answer, but if just to assure myself that it's been looked at, you know, when we were dealing with the Hillside Ordinance, we adopted a concomitant provision that actually isn't particular to the Hillside Ordinance, allowing people to rebuild their properties if they are lost by due to a casualty loss, where they had it.
Right.
I've come to the conclusion, I think, that this doesn't affect that.
Right.
But, you know, this was a little bit beyond my ability to make that comparison. Mm-hmm.
In the zoning.
It's in the zoning code, but I mean, there are this talks about how things have to be built and the kinds of things, the specifications they have to be built to. And I didn't know if that adversely affected in any way. I don't think it does, but I was just curious if we could at least make assure ourselves that that's true before second reading. And the other thing I was not able to completely put together was when we adopted the new Hillside Management Zone, it contains a lot of provisions. And it cross-references other codes, I believe, and other aspects about how things get built in the Hillside. And the Los Angeles Regional Uniform Code that we are adopting here deals with some technical provisions of the Hillside for houses built on hillsides. And I just wanted some comfort that our current Hillside Ordinance is consistent with that, and if there's anything more restrictive within our current Hillside Ordinance, it probably should be called out just to be able to say that we have adopted it. And all our current hillside ordinance may do is just cross-reference what our current building codes are, but I think there are some additional restrictions with respect to fire safety and seismic safety that in the hillside zone that we just may need to make sure that we aren't accidentally compromising them because we didn't include them in these more restrictive amendments that we have to adopt.
Mm-hmm. We'll double check
that. Am I making
that.
Any sense at all?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Completely.
And we can add amendments later on. We just
yes.
can't go below the state requirement, right? The state standard.
We can't be more lenient.
Right.
Yeah, we can't be more lenient, but...
That kind of raises a couple of questions for me. Have we adopted the California Building Safety Code before?
We've done it
in previous years.
Every 3 years, you adopt whatever is adopted. And I don't believe that it's that in previous years it was the California Building Standards Code. It was a different code. But you adopted it 3 years ago. You would have had a similar action.
So the process of coming up with this list, which is seems pretty exhausted to me. It seems like a pretty lengthy list. The process of coming up with this list is basically just to go through what we have and to see what inconsistencies are in the new code.
You want to make sure that the things that Sierra Madre has adopted specifically for this community remain in effect.
Right.
So that if the new state building code is more lenient in those areas, you've adopted something that keeps your protections in place.
Right. All right. Mm-hmm. I just say that because I guess that these are amendments that we're putting forth now, but there may be, in fact, I mean, if we're looking code to code, there may be, in fact, other things that we are more restrictive on that we've not put forth.
Well, we think that we've caught all of them.
All right.
Yeah.
Right.
And we can, if for some reason there's something that you want to adopt in the future or that was missed on this list, we can come back and do that.
All right.
Okay. Well, the only reason I asked that is I thought there was some sort of deadline where we had to get things adopted by January 1, 2008.
Right, because...
Or the other code goes into effect
yes,
as a matter of course.
It would go into effect without those amendments.
But we can amend any time during the course of the calendar year after that?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. I thought there was some sort of deadline.
Well, the next 3 years until we adopt the next code.
Yes. Okay. All right.
Other questions? Okay. Then thank you, Ann, and I will... Now open the public hearing, and is there anybody who would like to comment on the 2007 building code adoption? Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, bring it back to the council.
I will move that we adopt the ordinance here, which is there an ordinance number?
We're introducing it for first reading, I think.
All right, well, that by we introduce for first reading ordinance 1273 by title only. The title is, what is the title?
That long thing on page 3. Keep going, next page. There you go.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Sierra Madre adopting by reference pursuant to Government Code Section 50022.2, the 2007 California Code of Regulations Title 24, the 2007 California Building Standards Code with certain exceptions, modifications, and additions in amending the Sierra Madre Municipal Code.
And waive further reading.
Okay. Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any further comment? Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay. So we have a building code. Well, we almost have a building code. It comes back next time. But we do have a fire code. All right, that concludes item number 5. And item number 6, I don't know if you have any setup time. I know you're going to do a presentation. I was going to propose a 5-minute break while you do that, and then we'll come back and start with item number 6. All right, thank you.
Thank you.